Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. Today I wanted to talk a little bit more about those twisted experiments of Clovis Bray on Europa. There's tons of them that are recorded in the confidential Bray Lab Records lore book, and we went over a few of them in the previous video that I did on the Icefall Mantle. These experiments are mostly pretty gruesome, as we witnessed last time, what with the exploding stomachs and the additional arms being grafted to that one poor Exo, who then promptly tore them off. However, they do provide us incredible insights into the various scientific advancements that were being made in Eventide, and it relates more generally, in some instances, to the wider story of Clovis Bray and his journey about discovering what did and didn't work with the Exos and the various parts and pieces that made them all tick. So with that in mind, we're going to go through all of these different experiments, and we're going to get an idea of what it was like living as a test subject, or a scientist, or as a maniacal overlord in Eventide, or on the Morning Star, or anywhere vaguely in the area of European airspace. So yeah, fun stuff. Let's start with a few experiments that were clearly made after the gateway to Volantis 2082 was opened. For those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, Volantis 2082 is the forge star that the Vex come from on the other side of the glassway. Yes. When it says Belmon retreats to the void in the Glassway Strike, they are going back through that portal, and the portal leads to that forge star called Volantis 2082. So, yeah, fun stuff. For those of you that also didn't know, this portal was where Clovis Bray was siphoning off radiolurian fluid for experiments using the Exos. But in the process of doing that, well, there's a lot of nasty stuff that went on, including the injection and ingestion of radiolarian fluid by test subjects. That goes about as well as you'd expect. For those of you who don't know, radiolarian fluid is Vex mind fluid. When ingested, it will begin to override the organism and turn them into a Vex. We've seen it before with Ashamir and his Vex arm, and Kabir the Legionless, who eventually was completely transformed from a Guardian into a Vex, and his light was smothered. The two experiments that are listed are both the Radiolarian Fluid Injection and Ingestion lore books, and the two of them back-to-back have terrible consequences and read as follows. Record 3923E112, Europa. -0.280. Subject: Security Log E-098. Test number 142, Radiolarian Fluid Ingestion. Trial 1. Status confidential. Identities: C. Bray, J. Wong, Patient 1. Location: Europa, Deepstone Crypt. How does it taste? Metallic. Coarse. Something else. Does it feel digestible? It feels nourishing. It's cool. I can feel it making its way through me. This is encouraging. No immediate effects. Wait. What is it? Talk to us. Feels like it's attacking my stomach. Vomiting proceeds. Sir, his heart rate is spiking and his pressure is dropping. Damn it, he's losing fluids at an alarming rate. Exciting, isn't it? What's going to happen? He's going to die, that's what's going to happen. Fine, send in the medic units. Not sure if it's safe. We don't know if this is contagious. Could go airborne. How else are we going to find out? We send in the medic units. Obviously, fluid ingestion didn't work. But how about fluid injection? Well, that's what comes next. Record 4087E201, Europa -0.311. Subject: Security Log E-127. Test number 167, Radiolarian Fluid Injection, Trial 1. Status: Confidential. Identities: C. Bray, J. Wong, Patient 2. Location: Europa, Deepstone Crypt. That's twice now. Direct consumption and direct injection yield similar results. Airborne has been disproven, but direct contact with the fluid still produces corruption. I wish you wouldn't call it that. It's not corruption, it's reprogramming. I'd like to bring Helga into these sessions. She has an engineer's mind. She'll find the workarounds we need. Slimmer units, stronger materials, alternate power sources. I would advise against that. She's... The pursuit of science isn't always her top priority. When she sees what we're seeing, the precipice of a new age, she'll fall in line. I like working without jurisdiction. Wasn't that the point of us coming out here? With her track record, it'll only be a matter of time before the human ethics organizations come down on us. When did I ask for your opinion on this? Send in the cleanup crew and prep the next patient. Sir, his arm. It's transforming. Would you look at that? It appears to be replacing cells on an individual level. Can it be contained? Is there a way to stop the spread? We can amputate, but at this rate, I doubt we'd be fast enough. Perhaps exposure to clarity would slow it down. We need to control this. Study the arm. If he's going to die anyway, maybe we just amputate and pair the arm with another patient. But we don't currently have any other... Oh, wouldn't you like to have a shiny new arm? Don't you want to be stronger? Invulnerable? Don't act so surprised. You know what we're working towards. Promising prospect indeed. And we will potentially hear more about that arm. We see a later test being conducted on a human subject who is being given a robotic arm of some kind. Something metallic at very least. It's not clear whether this is the same arm, but considering that Helga Rasmussen is in the logs for that particular project. Yeah, not looking great for poor Justin Wong there. All that being said, though, Clovis's experiments with Vex Mind Fluid would of course lead him to the solution for the billboarding problems of the Exos. Vex Mind Fluid, exposed to clarity, would end up in a lower entropy state that would no longer be subject to the influence of the Vex. It's clear, however, that the Mind Fluid that was gathered was used for a variety of experiments before anything went on with this particular discovery. These two tests might not even have been the last few that were conducted with the mind fluid being inserted into someone's body. But for now, let's move on to something a little bit more tame. Nukes. Yes, I'm being serious. The next experiment involves nuclear-powered exos. Take a listen to this. Record 0872E136, SS-0.032. Subject, security log. A-123. Test number 088. Nuclear-powered EXO. Trial 01. Status confidential. Identities. C. Bray. D. Chambers. Location. Morningstar Orbital Platform. Europa. Unknown coordinates. Incoming call from MSOP. Caller ID. C. Bray. Sir, we're prepped and standing by for your order. And the reactor is stable? Stable and ready for installation in the Exo body. If this works, generations will praise the work accomplished today. Sir, if you don't mind me saying, the team would have liked you to be here personally. Would have been a vote of confidence for them. May I remind you, it was your insistence we find an alternate power source to Clarity, even though it already has proven to be a success. Besides, if that reactor explodes with me present, it would be the single greatest loss our civilization could suffer, and would damn us all for eons to come. Now get on with it. Yes, sir. Install the core. Are you able to see well enough? I'm watching with bated breath. Calculated distance of 3 millimeters, 2 millimeters, 1 millimeter. We're in. Lock the chassis, switch on the alternator, and reroute power supply. Nothing is happening. It would appear not. If nuclear power isn't a sufficient power source, perhaps there are other uses. It's non-compatible at the very least. It is interesting to note that the chassis may be able to house other forms of power with similarly destructive potential. We may have a walking bomb on our hands. Call ended. It's interesting to take a look at this and see that we can kind of timestamp when in the development of the Eventide colony and Clovis's various experimental facilities being set up this was actually taking place. And the reason I say that is because Clarity is being mentioned as a viable power source for the Exos, which means that if that's the case, it may simply be a way of Clovis at least stating that this was after he had discovered Clarity. This could also potentially be a form of stating that it was after Clovis had discovered that Clarity Control and Vex Mind Fluid in proximity to each other would be able to create something that stopped the Exos experiencing billboarding and therefore allowed them to function. But again, all of that being said, anything to do with this is a little bit vague. It's just nice that we get some kind of vague idea on what's going on in these tests, and honestly, what's going on with regards to the timing of all this. Can you imagine that, though? If you managed to shoot an Exo in the wrong place and they just blew up. And I mean, really, just nuke. Like, 25 kill streak. It's just everybody dies. Match over. Mission failed. Get them next time. Anyway, moving on, let's go ahead and talk about something different. Namely, let's go ahead and talk about the Vex and the portal at the center of the Glassway. For those of you who don't know what the Glassway is really doing, it's the source of all of the radiolarian fluid that Clovis was getting, and as I explained earlier, it links to that forge star known as Volantis 2082. However, in order to understand that, they had to go through said portal, and I think this next log is talking about experiments where they're doing just that. After they went ahead and created the portal, you need to be able to actually access it safely. And of course, Clovis wasn't going to be the first one to step through that thing, not at all. Instead, he had participants take place. So, here is the record of what happened to them, and yeah, before anyone asks, it ends badly. Record 4987E230, Europa-0.403. Subject, Security Log E-205, Test Number 259, Trans-Temporal Crossing, Trial 3, Status Confidential, Identities, C. Bray, J. Wong, Participants 01 through 05, Location, Europa Eventide Colony. Send them through. Participants, step forward through the portal, maintain your grasp on the tether. Count to 10, and step back out. Final bet, older or younger? Older. But if they come back younger, I'm going in next. I think we should get through more clinical trials before you subject yourself, sir. Here we go. They're through. Countdown. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Pull the tether and bring them back. Where are they? The tether appears to be stuck. Pull harder. Tighten the winch! It looks like it may snap. Maybe they like what they found. Or something is holding them there. It's giving. Here they come. A whip noise and splashing sounds can be heard. Ugh. Disgusting. You smell that? It's permeating through the glass. What are we looking at? Looks to be complete cellular deterioration. They're just mushy goop, for lack of a better term. Guess I won't be going in yet after all. Seems there are still some things man was not meant to conquer. If you believe that, you're in the wrong place, Justin. Just needs a little fine tuning. Nothing stops Clovis, really, does it? Not even a volunteer or two or five being snapped up by the Vex in a new forge star and being reduced to cellular sludge. Or maybe it wasn't even the Vex that did it. Maybe it was simply going through a portal through time and space that turned them to sludge. Of course, the portal was fixed and the access to the forge star Volantis 2082 was opened up, and this allowed Clovis and his team to gather the radiolarian fluid, and this would lead to the creation of the Exos. To change tack a little bit, let's go ahead and talk a little more about that arm experiment that we were looking at. This is a trial that actually also involves, again, Helga Rasmussen, who is one of the founding members of the Black Armory, and she also has a period of time here where she works in the Eventide Labs on Europa. In fact, it's something that she actually kind of brought back with her to the Black Armory. She's the entire reason why they were working on an Exo that would be a mobile forge. This, of course, eventually turned into Ada 1, who eventually was given the Obsidian Accelerator by us and unlocked her full potential. She was Project Niobe, But all this started with the Exos in Clovis Bray's lab, and Helga Rasmussen was there to see a part of it. This test in particular is one where we're seeing Clovis experimenting with a patient who had an exo arm attached to their body. Again, it says exo arm attachment, but I don't know if that's some way of saying some arm that is not human. Again, it's really not clear. Maybe it is the case that this is Justin Wong, I don't know. Having said all of that, yeah, let's go ahead and take a look. Record 5002E290, Europa-0.435. Subject, Security Log E-222. Test number 312, Exo Arm Attachment, Trial 4. Status, confidential. Identities, H. Rasmussen, C. Bray, Patient 32. Location, Europa, Eventide Colony. How about the index finger? No. Extremities remain unresponsive. Are there any sensations at all? Phantom ones, I have an itch I'd like to scratch. My chest feels heavy, like someone is sitting on me. While nerve endings are attached to the mechanism successfully, we are not generating action potentials. This isn't working, Helga. Still progress, you'll have to settle for that. I typically don't settle for anything. Hello? I'm struggling to breathe. He's experiencing a massive myocardial infarction. Send in the medic units. I fear my earlier hypothesis was correct, and the human body in its current evolution cannot sustain the physical exertion the machine parts demand. Then we should evolve. Oh, okay. Let me just jump ahead 100 million years real quick. We've had some interesting advancements in post-transcriptional modification, gene splicing with primates, fish, and some birds. What if we built stronger humans? Could they withstand this process? I'm an engineer, not a geneticist. I don't know if your ape men can wield a metal arm. That's such a reductive and tasteless comprehension of what I'm proposing. He's flatlined. We've lost him. Well, you know what they say. If at first you don't succeed. A quick note to be made is that maybe that last bit towards Justin Wong is just a threat. I don't think that he would have died considering that he is in the later ice-wielding experiment, and I have to presume that that is later considering the state at which that particular card is found. It feels as though this is after they have mastered the effects of clarity, but again, I can't be sure. Let's just simply say that at bare minimum, he threatened Justin Wong with being someone who was going to be used in these trials. And let's also note that this is trial number 4. Maybe this is late enough that it's already happened. Terrifying possibility. Anyway, Helga Rasmussen would of course go on to work with the Black Armory's other two founding families to create a stockpile of fantastic weapons that they would use as a means of defending themselves and those closest to them during the days of the collapse. They didn't see the collapse coming in quite the apocalyptic sense that it would, but they did anticipate that there would be an end to the Golden Age and that in those days they would have a need for self-defense. All of this, of course, would lead to Project Niobe, the Forges, and of course, Ada One, who we've met in the season of the Forge and who will be returning next season. The final confidential Bray Lab record is something that relates to what we'll be talking about in our next episode in the Journals of Clovis Bray, and it's all to do with the terrifying results of exposure to clarity control, namely exposure of those who happen to work under Clovis Bray, and of course, clarity control is going to kill them. For those of you who don't know, by the way, clarity control is the statue, the darkness statue, that we see in the Deepstone Crypt raid. Exposure to darkness artifacts has previously happened in the story of the K1 Project and their encounter with the anomaly, which led to the death of everyone at the base sites on Luna in the various K1 Project bases such as K1 Communion or K1 Logistics. Unfortunately, clarity control had a very similar effect on those humans that were encountering it on Europa, and those were recorded in the Bray Lab records. So, let's go ahead and listen to the unfortunate fate of those who happen to be working around clarity control. Record 1560E308 SS-0.287. Subject, security log A-322. Test number 140, clarity control exposure, trial 3. Status, confidential. Identities, C. Bray, M. Muniz. Location, Morningstar Orbital Platform. Sir, we have reports coming in from Clarity Control.
About time. Well?
They're dead, sir.
How many?
All of them.
And they all came in physical contact with it?
No, sir. Some were merely within proximity. I have a recording if you'd like to see it.
Right away.
Recording plays.
Did you hear it? You all hear that?
Hear what?
It's speaking.
Mom?
Is that you?
No, don't go near—
Unintelligible screams, choking, and fluids spilling follows. The recording ends.
Fascinating. It appeared to be communicating with them.
I wonder what it said.
With your permission, we'd like to quarantine the area and restrict all access.
I'd like to try a different approach.
Send in some fresh faces. Tell them nothing, except to keep their distance. I'd like to know what it's saying.
Of course, these experiments aren't all that happened at Eventide or the Morning Star, or even just in the Deepstone Crypt, but some of the darker ones did indeed involve Clarity Control, Stasis, and the Exos. This last experiment is particularly terrifying, considering that it is a direct replication of what seems to be the final fate of everyone on the K1 project. So it means that anyone who is maybe not paracausal and sits around these darkness artifacts for long enough is going to see a similar fate befall them. Not particularly pleasant. Very scary. Here's the terrifying thing, though. Putting aside the darkness, and the powers of stasis, and the Vex technology, and the Exos that were experimented on here, and the unethical trials that went place generally, and consider this. There must have been hundreds, if not thousands, of trials, tests, and experiments that took place in the cold darkness of Europa. The real terror here is the sheer volume and depth of human suffering that was on display. The progress made may have been substantial, but unquestionably, this progress came at a cost that was too high. Again, if there's a message with all of this, it is unquestionably this. Always be ready to understand the consequences of your potential actions, and if you see those costs as something that is too high, don't undertake those actions. Some things are not worth it. Anyway, with all of that being said, thank you for going on this rather grotesque adventure with me, and hopefully you enjoyed that. And keep in mind that we're going to be jumping back in with the story of Clovis Bray very soon. The season is coming to an end. I feel like we've actually had a very good season's worth of content, and we're covering a whole load of stuff. There are a few other videos I want to do on the season of The Chosen just before we round it out, but if there's anything you think I've missed, please let me know in the comments section down below. I have one of them coming out for you guys on Sunday that I think is going to be particularly interesting to those of you who've been following Crow's story. And right now, I'm playing with the idea of whether I want to be sitting here and working on the Deepstone Crypt lore raid video before I do anything else. Of course, I have about a week's worth of time in which I could end up doing that, and it would be a bigger video than usual, so a lot of work. But anyway, with all of that being said, let me know what you want in the next few days. I would love to get your input. If you enjoyed this video though, go ahead and leave a like, and if you want more Destiny content, go ahead and hit subscribe, and the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. But in the meantime, as per usual, know that your viewership, as always, is quite enough for me, and that my name has been, my name is Bife. Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.